Hello, this is extra video for chapter 2 based on feedback on chat and Q&A session. A little bit more about what is likelihood, why do we need the normalization term, plotting a continuous function, why probability density can be larger than 1, and why we sometimes explicitly condition on model M. In the lecture, I drew binomial model and divide observation model. So binomial distribution is useful when we have certain number of trials, for example, 10. For each trial, some probability that something happens. So here theta 0.5. And then based on this equation, we can compute the probability that y is observed to be 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And we can also now look at these numbers here. And also, as this is, it's a conventional that, so the probability that something is impossible is 0. So probability of y being less than 0 is 0. And probability of any event is 1. So probability of y being 10 or less is 1. And we can check that these numbers sum to 1. We can also look another distribution with just changing theta to 0.9, and these probabilities for different y values change, but again these sum to 1. After we have the observation model, then we have the question that what if we then actually observe something? Let's say we observe y is equal to 6. In that case, we can see that okay, probability given theta is 0.5, probability of observing 6 is 0.21. On the other hand, we can look at what if theta is 0.9, then the probability of observing y is 6 is 0.01. Just comparing these two things, it seems that if we observe y is 6, yes, it's possible in either theta value, but more likely with theta being 0.5. Instead of just comparing these two theta values, we can compare more. Here, these different theta values are 0.0, 0.1, 0.2, and so on. And I bolded here, you may remember, when theta was 0.5, probability that y is 6 is 0.21. And when theta is 0.9, probability that y is 6 is 0.01. So these are still the probabilities for y being equal to 6, but for different theta values. We can add even more evaluations with different theta values. We could add even more, but it's also just the point about the plotting continuous function. So theta is a continuous valued parameter, but in practice, we can evaluate it only in finite number of locations. So here it's been evaluated in 101 locations. We can connect the dots with lines and remove the dots, and it looks like a continuous function. It still has been evaluated only in finite number of points, but it looks smooth and continuous. And now we have then for all possible theta values. The point here is telling what is the probability of observing 6 given this theta value. But instead of thinking that what is the probability of getting 6 with this theta value, we can also say that it's telling how likely each theta value is given we observe y, and then this function is called likelihood function. This likelihood function looks like probability distribution, but there's something different to usually used probability distributions. As in this discrete case, we want to have that, okay, probability of theta being less than 0 is 0, and probability that theta is less than 1 is 1. And the probability for theta being less than 1 is then, just a moment, my pen starts working. And so the probability that theta is less than 1 is all this area here under the curve. So we want to now find out what is the probability mass here. So we could integrate, but we can also now just by, I looked at, okay, here if we draw a triangle, this triangle contains, it has about the same area as our this distribution curve. The width of the base is less than 1, height is about 0.25. So if we multiply them, it's somewhere around 0.2. And then from the area of triangle, we divide by 2. And then we get that area of this distribution is about 0.1. And it's not integrating to 1. So this is not normalized posterior distribution, even if the shape is, it's not normalized distribution, even if the shape is, looks like distribution. And we can also look so that if we now numerically integrate over this, as shown here, we get quite close what I expected. So we need to normalize this to make it to be normalized distribution, and then it's easier to compute different probabilities from that. So this is solved by, so that we have the likelihood there, we could also multiply by prior, and this term here then makes for us the normalization. And this is just the integral over what is on the top. So we are just doing what I did in the last figure, integrating and finding out what is the currently the area under that curve and divide by that. And then area under the curve here will be, so if this will integrate to 1, and then it's normalized distribution. So that's why we need the normalization. So in the lecture, we started with the uniform prior, making it a bit easier, and then putting there just the observation model, but looking at it as a now function of theta, so the likelihood, integral of that likelihood. Now, these terms don't depend on theta, so they cancel out. So on top, we have this term, and then this z will be this integral. And then this integral happens to have this form with the gamma functions, which with the integers are same as factorial. And we can now try what happens if we integrate this. So notice that previously I integrated over something which had only also that combinatorial term, which we had now dropped off. So we're now just integrating over this, which is same as in here. And we get this value. And then on the other hand, here we are computing this gamma, which is same as here, and we get the same value. And so by dividing this value in case of this y equals 6 and equals 10, we get normalized posterior distribution. And here you can see the normalized posterior distribution. And then there was a question that how it is possible that when they were computing with d beta function that they got density which was larger than one. For densities, it is possible to be larger than one. What is important is that when we integrate over, we might be also interested in just integrating part of this, for example, this part. So what is the probability that theta is less than half? It's important that this area is less than one. So the integral up to here is less than one. Or we might be then interested in integrating over the whole thing. And again, we can make a quick check that this seems to be integrating to one. So draw a triangle, base, and like here. So the base is less than one, height is about 2.5. And so it's maybe 2, multiply them together and then divide by 2. And so the area is about the one. And of course, we know from the math that it's actually exactly one. There was also a question then that in the lecture slides, there was also this M, that what is that compared to other things? And so sometimes we write also this M and condition on the model. So explicitly showing that. Reasons for this are, it makes it more clear that likelihood and prior are both part of the model. So here, both the likelihood has M and prior has M, so they are both describing the same model. It also makes it more clear that there's no absolute probability. So something that Y could depend just on number of trials, but it also depends on the model M. In this case of binomial model, this is not so easy to see the difference. But when we go to more complex models, it's more clear that it's sometimes helpful to remind about this. Also, this normalization term, it's also actually when the Y is observed, it has also the form of the likelihood. So we have now likelihood for model M1 and likelihood for model 2, and these are called marginal likelihoods because we here marginalized away the prior. And this is discussed more in chapter 7. And so now it is enough that you understand its normalization term, but then there are cases where it is useful to also remind that all this is happening conditional on some model and model assumptions. And then the reason to usually drop it out is just because in cases where you are looking just at one model, then we can make the notation more concise.